Well, I wasn't planning on taping again today, but if something really important comes up, what I do is I share it with the world, absolutely. And something very important has come up. I'm in a very dire circumstances, you might say. And so I'm giving it everything I've got to make some kind of breakthrough. So I say to the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, whatever you want me to look at and say, and okay, I'll do it. And so I'm sitting there at my desk, and somehow I just suddenly saw what the problem is with quote-unquote our life. And to tell you the truth here, to be just, you know, direct, it, what is our problem is our life. Our life is our problem. That is our problem. And I saw why, and I said, of course. Never saw that before. And I just, oh my gosh, okay. And then I remember Jesus telling us, oh my gosh, he who would seek to gain his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake shall gain it. And I said, oh, now I know what Jesus is talking about. And then I said, wow, no wonder why it's so difficult in this world. Everybody thinks that they need a life. That's the last thing they need. That's what you don't need. It's impossible to have a life, actually. This is what messes everyone up. We think we need a life. We don't need a life. How can absolute spontaneous freedom need a life? It's the most absurd thing ever to think. So we're trying to construct a life, and that is the problem. He who would seek to gain his life, to gain a life for themselves, will lose real life. And he who loses this life that we call, you know, that we're trying to gain, he who sets that down will find real life. Not a life, but just one eternal life. That is not a life that we think of, I need a life. I need to build a life. I need to have a good life. I need a life. That's the whole problem, actually. But you just almost never hear that in this world. It's taken as an absolute premise in this world that, of course, we're here to have a life. Why else could, well, you know, it's like a fundamentally unquestionable premise that we need a life. And this is exactly what is wrong. What we truly are has absolutely no need for a life. Absolutely no need for a life. That's, in fact, from standpoint of reality, that is so completely, absolutely absurd. You can't even hardly explain how absurd it is. Reality is completely open and free, spontaneously. All potentiality is available to all, always and forever, with no residue and no reactions and no after effects and no nothing. So, what do you mean? I need a life. What do you mean? I am life. So, anyway, what we're doing here is just bringing this up for the sake of familiarity. Don't struggle with it mentally. Full stop in the wow. Okay, first, don't ever struggle with anything mentally. Full stop in the wow. Or emotionally, mentally or emotionally. Just don't struggle. Just say, okay, wow. This is really like, wow. What I'm hearing is just wow. I think in the Bible, I wrote this down, Matthew 10:39, something like that. That's it. It's a very famous saying. And Jesus repeats that in Journey Beyond Words. He explains it, I believe. Says, that's what I meant when I say he who... But I never put it together or saw, you know, what's being talked about here. I don't think very few do, actually. It's just not stressed here. Oh, my God. So I say to Jesus, take my life, please take it. Here. I don't want a life. Are you kidding me? That's like the biggest curse there ever could possibly be. To say that you have a life is the biggest curse. That is the whole problem, actually. And that's why Jesus says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them all go. Let what you think is your life go. That's the problem, is trying to have a life. That is the problem. And we don't dig deep enough. We think, no, my problem is that I'm not having a good enough life. No, the problem is we're trying to have a life. That's the problem. And again, don't struggle with this. I saw it very clearly. So I'm not going to try and explain every detail just so people don't struggle. Don't struggle with it. Just hear it. And intuitively, you see, there's something here intuitively that's right. I know that. So I have a little bit of hope now. I said, maybe I can get rid of my life. And then I'll be able to be life, you know? Because really, my quote-unquote life is killing me, you know? That's what's killing me. That's what's causing the problems. My life is what the problem is. I don't need a new life. No. I don't need any life. And then I'll be free. I will be life. I will realize I am life itself. So I said, Jesus, if there's some way you can take my life, please take it. Absolutely, my gosh. And so I realized this morning that I'm making the same mistake over and over and over and over and over my whole quote-unquote life. But I couldn't quite understand what's wrong. I said this morning, I realized every day is the exact same problem, but it's just in different packaging. Every single day of my life is the same problem. But I didn't quite realize until this evening that it's when I accepted the idea that I'm supposed to have a life, that's when the problem started. And ever since then, every single day is the same problem. What's my problem? My life is the problem. It's the same problem. I'm trying to have a life. I said, this is a problem. This is ridiculous. I don't need a life. What do I need a life for? I'm spirit. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm formless with all potentiality at my fingertips, so to speak, available to me. Why do I need a life then? What do I need a life for? Just let us say, what in the world do I need a life for after all? Wow, how crazy. So, there must be, Jesus says, we can relax our mind, release our thoughts, and let them go. There's somehow we can get free of our lives. And I need to get free of my life in a hurry. That is for sure. My life has become too problematical, to say the least. Because I'm not able to relate anymore socially or do anything, because all that happens is everybody reinforces the idea that I need a life. And intuitively, I know this is wrong. No. They make things worse. Even the ones that are well-intentioned make things worse. The last thing I want to hear is that, let me make your life better or something. No. So I'm adverse to social interaction because it's always made it worse, actually. Because deep down, I have this intuitive realization that, wait a minute, no, it's life that's the problem, not the solution. So everybody is full of these ideas of how to make their lives better. And that's the last thing I want to hear. I just shut them off like that, you know. Not interested. I'm not interested in how to make my life better. And nobody gets it at all. They don't get it at all. It never enters their mind what the problem really is. So thank God, and thank the Holy Spirit, and thank Jesus, and thank myself that I was able to really focus on this. I'm focusing on this to such a huge extent to try and make breakthroughs here that I was able to see this now. That's a big step for sure. And so what do you do now? We're full stop in the wow. I mean, this is like super wow. And so just keep the same discipline as always. That's why I say the good habits, the right habits, are what ultimately succeeds for you. Is the work ethic. The work ethic, the sitting quietly, sitting stilly, being able to focus in, and then full stop in the wow, be patient, get used to it, get familiar, don't, you know, all this stuff, the basics are what enable this to catch these glimpses and say, oh, now I see it. Wow. Now I see it. Wow. He who would seek to gain his life shall lose it. And he who loses his life, or gives up his life for my sake, shall gain it. Meaning for the sake of eternal life. Shall gain eternal life, really, is what Jesus is saying. Shall gain eternal life. And now I just saw it. Who can really see that? It is, which, not easy, you struggle with it. And so people think, oh, you know, you can't be without a life. That's horrible. No, to be with a life is horrible. That's what's absolutely horrible and horrid and terrible. And thank God for Jesus who knows this and informs us of this. He's right. Yeah, absolutely right. And that glimpse I saw, I said, oh, yeah. I'm not sure how to get rid of it. He says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let it go. See, it's not the body we're talking about. No. We're not talking about suicide or dying or something. No. No, it's the idea that we need a life is the problem. Who needs a life? The body? The body doesn't need a life. The body is just neutral. It doesn't need any life at all. So who is it that he says it needs a life? Spirit is saying that. Spirit's saying it needs a life. What do you mean it already has eternal life? That is its life. So we're spending all this time trying to fix our lives. And that is the problem. That's what I saw this morning. I said, every day of my life, I've been trying to fix my life. Every single day of my life, I have been trying to fix my life. And I realized I'm doing the exact same thing every day, is trying to fix my life. I said, I also realized, wow, this is totally stupid, isn't it? I said, yeah. And I said, great. And I had this positive reaction, like, finally I've seen my stupidity. And we're trying to make stupidity absolute, as if it then becomes some new law that we can live under, absolute stupidity. And now it just stays, continually stays stupid. I said, I've been stupid my whole life, haven't I? And I said, yeah. I said, well, fine, great, finally I'm seeing it. And I wasn't upset, I said, this is wonderful. I've been extremely stupid my entire life. And of course, having a life means trying to fix it every day, which is completely stupid. So everybody's being completely stupid. As long as you have a life, you're being completely stupid every day. As long as you have that life, every single day that you have a life, you're being completely stupid. But I was able to see this and accept it and say, oh, great, finally I see this. It's wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. But I didn't quite see what I was trying to do. I knew I was making the same mistake every day of my life. And now I see it's every day of my life. Having a life is the stupid mistake. And then trying to fix it, that is our life. Our life is really trying to fix our life. So we can feel like, well, it's right to have a life. I need a life. I need a life. I gotta fix it. It's not quite right. It's not quite right. It's not quite right. All the while, we're ignoring eternal life that we already have, that we already are. That which can have anything and everything, always and forever, how can they need a life? How can they say, well, you know, first I got to have this, and then I got to do this, and see, this, I need to construct a life. We don't need to construct a life. All life is eternally available to us, always. Whatever you want to call life, all experiencing is already eternally available to us, always. That is our life, already. Some people say, well, you got a body, you got to have a life, you got to give that body a life. The body needs a life. No, the body doesn't need a life. As Anandamayi said, if it weren't for you asking me spiritual questions and desiring spiritual instruction and inspiration, the body would just lie in a corner like a heap of rags and be completely immobile and frozen like ice. The body has absolutely no need to have any life. And I have absolutely no need to give the light a life to a body. I already have eternal life. So the body doesn't need a life. But we here can still use the body as Jesus says, as a communication device. And free of this so-called life that we've been trying to give it, body, the body functions perfectly according to Jesus. It will function perfectly as a communication device for as long as you want to use it. Won't suffer. It'll be perfectly functional for that. Right. So we're just letting this filter in, letting this filter in. This is great content. This is breakthrough content here. I know the videos are long and probably a lot of people don't get to them, but what can I do? I mean, this is breakthrough content, and the whole purpose is get familiar with it. It's not here for here. It's not for superficial processing. It's for letting it sink into the wow point. And getting used to that, like, wow, getting used to this wow around this information, this content, this sharing. It is really wow. I don't need a life at all. Nobody does. In fact, the worst thing you could ever do to anyone is tell them that they need a life. That's the worst advice ever. Because we all are life. We are life. Eternal life. All life. If you even want to use that term, we don't even need to use that term. We are everything, always. We're spirit. We're not bodies. I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So. The amazing thing was my positive response is very positive. I said, oh, great. I don't need a life. That's ridiculous. Wonderful. I've been stupid, repeating the same stupid mistake every day of my life. Great. Now I can wonderful. I see that. Well, yeah. That's all we do is repeat the same stupid mistake every day of our life. Because every day with a life is the same stupid mistake. Thinking that I need a life. That's the stupid mistake. Thinking that the body needs a life. They say you gotta give a life to the body. So here we are, slaves to the body, trying to give the body a life. the body's actually an inert, neutral symbol, basically. It knows nothing about life. And as by the great saint show this, Ramana Maharshi, no regard for the body, absolutely did not identify with it at all. Anandamayi, no regard for the body, no identification with the body whatsoever. And she said, I can't even differentiate between pleasure and pain. I see absolutely no differentiation in the body. I don't identify with the body at all. So they didn't believe her, so she picked up a coal out of the fire and just held it in her hand. And it just started burning right through her hand. And the other people screamed, and, knock the coal, what are you doing? Just, I don't feel anything. They said, well, they just burned a hole in you. They had this, terrible sore. I don't identify with the body in the slightest bit. Body is nothing. Totally neutral. So we have these great examples, very recent examples. Jesus is a great example. Further back in history. And Ramana Maharshi, too, just body's nothing. He says, body is nothing. Just an empty shell. And yet here we are, frantically trying to give the body a life. Maybe trying to bring the body to life, perhaps. Anyway, we don't need to dig too much. It's a little more intuitive than this. It's seeing it in a flash. You see it. You realize, perfect freedom needs a life. How is having a life perfect freedom? How can perfect freedom have a life? It's perfectly free. Each moment to experience whatever it wants to experience. How can we define a life for that? See, what we're trying to do is we're trying to define life. When we say, I need a life, what we're saying is we need to work on defining what life is, and defining what a life is. And we use bodies to help us define. The body is just a reference we use to try and define reality. How can you define perfect freedom? You can do anything you want with that, always. There's no set definition anywhere for it. And since there isn't no set definition, how can you talk about a life at all? In terms of a defined life, it's absurd. It's absurd. So, but then again, we're feeling this, so we do full stop in the wow here. We don't try to explain it so much. But just can you feel it? Like, I don't need to fashion a life. I'm not a creature of a life. I'm not a creature at all. I'm not a creature that needs some sort of life in order to live, in order to be alive, in order to be life. I am life. I don't need to have a life. I am life. I don't need to be alive. I am life. I know I already successfully am life. I know I already successfully know. I already successfully am life. I know I already successfully know. I already successfully am life. He who will lose his life for my sake shall gain it. And he who seeks for his seeks for his life shall lose it. I know I already successfully... No. I already successfully am life. I know I already successfully know I am already successfully life. I know I already successfully know that I already successfully am life. I already successfully am life. I already am life. I am already life. I already am life. I already successfully am life. To put it into some sort of practice here, which is very helpful for us, to keep us from trying to overthink it. You see, this is very intuitive. You catch an intuitive glimpse of it, then you don't want to overthink it. So you want to go into practicing. I already am successfully life. I know I already successfully know that I already am successfully life. I know I already successfully know that I already successfully am life. So this is a new practice that's come up, which is even stronger perhaps than anything before. And of course parents would say, what are you talking about? I gave you life. I gave you an opportunity in life. I gave you an opportunity to have a life. That's not life, that's death. What they're really saying, I gave you an opportunity to have a death. You know, wow, I gave you an opportunity to have a death. He who seeks to gain his life shall lose it. Who gave the opportunity? The body did it. The body is neutral. It doesn't have any wants or needs or desires at all, actually. So who gave a spirit? Spirit. Why? Trying to be greater than God. Trying to define life. Trying to be beyond life. Like as if there's some life beyond life. So thanks, but no thanks for that. I know I already successfully know that I already successfully am life. That I already successfully am life. I know I already successfully know that I already successfully am life. 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 So what do you do if you don't have, haven't had the intuitive insight and seen it, this and that? What you do is you get used to hearing this, used to the wow of it, just the hearing, like wow. It's like, wow, what if this is true? Like, wow, maybe this is true. Like, wow, how do I feel? And what are my reactions to this? You know, wow. So it's not about me, it's about you. It's about your reactions. It's about your reactions. And the full stop and the wow, and just let them be there. Like, wow, this is astonishing. Could this be so? Yeah, this is astonishing. And then not struggling with the struggle. Don't struggle. Whatever. Just don't struggle in any way. I'm just getting familiar with this. I'm not struggling with it. I'm getting familiar with this. So I need to lose my life for the sake of eternal life very quickly. That is for sure. Because I'm not able to put up with the nonsense anymore in the world. So I have to function as a teacher, so to speak, at some point, because I can't relate anymore. I cannot socialize. I have zero patience now. I realize I'm making the same mistake over and over. Now I know what it is, the same thing. Every day in my life has been the same mistake over and over and over. Why? There's been a day in my life, that's why. And anyone who suggests that I should try to spend another day fixing my life, the door's closed on that. But you can't really function socially in civilization, society, once you see this, unless you're teaching this, unless you're actually teaching this and saying, this is what I know, this is what I'm experiencing, then you can relate in that way. And then people can at least understand why you're adamant about, you can say, hey, this is the truth. Don't tell people get a life. Say, realize that you don't need a life. Realize that you don't need a life. The reason why people are angry and cranky and the way they are in the world is because they're trying to fix their life. They think they need a life, and it's not working for them. And they're saying, every single day I get up and I got to work all day to try to fix my life, and they're upset. And they get, start talking politics, they invent their upset. I'm upset, your policies are, bothering me. I'm so upset. No, they're upset because they're trying to fix their life. They're upset because they have a life, actually. And of course, this seems like utter blasphemous, crazy talk to virtually everyone on the face of this earth, which is why it's very difficult to get to this in a positive vein like this and celebrate and say and recognize, wow, this is the breakthrough I've been waiting for. That's tremendous. Because if you're tied in with the rest of the people in the world, there's no way you're going to get to this, because they'll say you're absolutely completely insane. I need to help you. I need to help your life. We need to do an intervention, make sure we need to fix your life, is what they'll say. So yeah, it's difficult to get to this for sure. That's why I'm like reclusive. I shun people, because they'll try to fix your life. If you try to talk to them, what's wrong? I say, nothing's wrong. I never say anything's wrong. Well, nothing's wrong. Everything's fine. Because they're eager to try to fix your life. I can help you fix your life. Because they think that in helping you fix your life, that'll fix their life. And there's this whole chain of, Jesus calls it helping to hurt. And it really, that's what it is. Everybody in the world is thinking that, if I can just help somebody else, maybe that'll fix my life. I can just help somebody else fix their life, that'll help me fix my life. Or, in some way everyone's trying to fix their life. And it's having a life that's the problem. That's what needs to be seen. And again, thank God for Jesus Christ, who saw this and alerted us to this and continues to do so, along with all the others who have seen it and alerted us to it as well. But fortunately, we have the testimony of Jesus Christ very strongly in our culture, and we've heard this a million, so many times. He who would seek to gain his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake shall gain it. And Jesus was not talking about martyrdom of the body at all. But yet we've had this teaching in our lives, and we don't quite understand, haven't quite understood it. The priests and the pastors and whatever, struggle with explaining the gospel. They struggle, and it says, he means this, and we kind of say, I'm not sure that's what he means. But tonight I saw what Jesus meant. I actually saw it. I said, oh, bingo. Absolutely right. And thank God for the Holy Spirit, who helps clarify everything for us. Otherwise, we would still be, we would be perpetually trying to fix our lives, not understanding that the reason that the problem today is that I think I need a life. I'm trying to attain a life for myself. Why should eternal life need to attain a life for itself? It is absolutely absurd. And Jesus says, the last thing is you'll just have a good laugh and then that's it. He realizes this is so totally absurd. And so that's why I say humor, you must, in your spiritual wowism, keep bringing the humor in as much as you can, because you're feeling that there's some super absurdity, you know, and you need to look at it in a positive light and laugh at it. You say, oh my gosh, I knew every day of my life something was wrong. Well, that's because every day of my life I was trying to attain a life. That's the problem. Of course. I'm trying to fix that problem. So I feel like I got a problem I need to fix. What is it? Not realizing it's because I believe I'm supposed to have a life. That is the problem. So maybe it's, you know, they're bothering me, or maybe it's this, or maybe it's that, and I gotta work on fixing it. I just spent enormous effort my whole life to try to fix my life every day. In fact, I worked at it to such an extraordinary extent. Super dedicated. Every single day of my life, I've done everything possible to try to fix my life, and it only made things worse. And now realizing, oh, trying to have a life, that is the problem. So we don't need to worry about fixing anything anymore. We just need to just gently set it down. Just as it is, it doesn't matter how it is, because we already have eternal life. We don't need to do anything with our life at all. With this life we're trying to attain, we don't need to do anything at all. We can set it down exactly as it is right now, and that's it. Not even need to think about it ever again. Because whatever it is we have been experiencing, that too is eternally available to us. Always. So we're not losing anything, actually. We're gaining. And Jesus says, he will lose his life trying to have a separate life will gain eternal life. But words get in the way, as they always do. So it is more the shock of this that's important. The wow is way more important than the words. Wow is more important than the words. And yet the words are here to kind of help bring this wow about, you know. You need to ring the bell, dong. But the reverberations are more important. You know, it's not the bell, it's the reverberations. Like, wow, you're feeling this, what you feel. But it, you know, the words help hit the bell. But really, it's the mental seeing. I just sort of mentally, I saw this, mentally. I looked at absolute freedom. I said, wait a minute. If I'm absolute freedom, what am I doing trying to have a life? That doesn't make any sense. Something's cuckoo here. Yeah, so. Now, how do I feel now? Same. Stable. It's not like it has caused any problem or anything like that. But because it's a stay in the discipline, stay centered in the discipline, sit quietly, full stop in the wow. I'm not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And just keep affirming that. No struggle, because I look at it very positively, so very accepting of it. That's great. I'm finally going to be free of my life. What could be possibly better than that? Nothing. And we're not talking about dying at all, are we? Absolutely not. In fact, we're talking about setting down dying, actually. Because he who would try to seek his life and attain this life, is that will lose it, actually. That is death. That is death. We just project death onto the body and say that's where the death is. That's not where the death is. Body's neutral. It neither lives nor dies. It's to have a life. A separate life that's somehow not part of the all-inclusive, everything is always available, eternal life. A special life. Trying to have a special life. That no, this has to happen, and then this has to happen, and this has to be here, and that has to be here, and this is, I'm fashioning my life. This is my life. This is the center. This is, okay. That's the trouble. Again, we don't have a life. We are life. I know I already successfully know that I already successfully am life. Again, let this, the wow of the settle in instead of analyzing it mentally. Don't pick it apart philosophically. Try to speak in terms of affirmation and absolutes and breakthroughs and not philosophical picking things apart. That's the trouble. So the wow is already here. This is great. And just talking about this is an extreme wow. You don't hear many people talk like this. I haven't heard anyone talk like this myself, so I'm wowing myself. I said, wow. Not exactly. But there's been some. We read a book or something that there's something around the edges like that. Yeah. So... it's still very wowish, very much so. But not too much, this is fine. Enjoyable, actually. I guess Jesus isn't so stupid after all. I mean, there's like a massive global campaign to present a dumbed-down Jesus to the world. Absolutely there is. And it's really causing troubles for a lot of people, for sure. So it's great to know that Jesus is not some dumbed down, not dumbed down at all. Super, super smart, super, super wise. Don't fall for that dumbed down Jesus. Do not fall for that at all. Because then it's a lot easier than to get rid of Jesus altogether, isn't it? You say, why should we be paying so much attention to this guy who's really not that smart anyway, and what, he doesn't really have anything to tell us that anybody else couldn't tell us, so why are we spending so much time, and why are we having tax-exempt churches, and why are we... That's what they're going for. That's what they're going for, actually. Wiping out religion. Wiping out the potency of it. And someone, once the potency is gone, they say, why are we protecting this anyway? Special tax benefits, etc., etc., etc. No. This is an anachronism. It's an anachronism. Get rid of it. That's what they want. And, of course, they think they're so smart in doing this. They think they're outsmarting even Jesus, you see? And they think that they're fixing their lives by doing this. Whereas it's actually believing you need a life, that is the actual problem. That is the delusion. So, I don't know what's going to happen next for me. I told the Holy Spirit, hey, whatever it takes, we got to do it. You know, I need a new chapter. Then here's the problem. Chapter. I need a new chapter in my life? No, I don't need a new chapter in my life. I need to drop my life. I don't need the book of life at all. I need to throw the Book of Life away entirely. And he who would lose his life for my sake shall gain it. For my sake, meaning Jesus standing for eternal life, of course. Eternally refreshing. I am the way. I am the truth and the life and the way to what? Eternal life. I am eternal life. Ember told, well, you know, our lives will never measure up to Jesus' life, but that's the way it's supposed to be. That's how God created us. But God reaches down and gives us mercy and compassion in our lives and helps us and blah, 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 goes on and on. No, they're completely missing it. Totally missing it. I didn't... The last homily in the last Mass in Catholic Church was suffering. And they said, why do you suffer? Anyone know why you suffer? You know, silently says, he says, nobody knows. Nobody knows why we suffer, but we do. This is just part of life. So this is part of life. No, we suffer because we have a life. That's why we suffer. We're trying to have a separate life. We're trying to attain a life. We're seeking a life. That's why we're suffering. And then they wanted to say, well, nobody can get rid of suffering. It's impossible. We just have to not turn into misery. And so the whole thing about religion is to help us carry our burdens of suffering and realize this is just part of life and you know, can't do anything about it. I was like saying, oh my gosh, come on, this is ridiculous. That's not the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you don't have a life, you set down your life, you don't have suffering anymore. The suffering is your life. Trying to have a life is what your suffering is. That is the suffering. And the body has nothing to do with it, so don't talk about, you know, setting down the body. Your body has nothing to do with it, so leave your body out of this. Leave the body out of this. This is a spiritual situation. Body's got nothing to do with this talk at all. Thank you, Jesus, for being absolutely audaciously wise and helpful. Absolutely audaciously so. Even to tell us straight out, you know. He who would seek to gain his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake shall gain it, shall gain eternal life. The audacity to say that to all of us in the world, you know, wonderful. That's absolutely true. It is absolutely true. All right, let's not struggle with that. Stay with the wow. You have to get back to the wow and say, drop all the struggle. Drop all the struggle. Not important. All that stuff's not important. Not important. What's important? Familiarity. Familiarity is important. Once you can get positively familiar with this, familiar in a positive way, this is what's super important. Because this helps evaporate the continuity fear that we have. As I say, the only problem we really have is the continuity fear. Absolutely. The only problem we really have is the continuity fear. So positive familiarity means sitting in the wow. Stay positive about it. Just no, I'm gonna stay positive. Just no spin. Just stay with it. This is what really advances you. And of course, it helps a great deal to have someone who's audacious enough to say this stuff. That was my nickname when I was young. And it was audacious. You know, they gave me this nickname for being audacious. I was very audacious in speaking stuff, ideas, and saying stuff. They kind of joked about it, but it was shocking to people. So, having someone who's audacious enough to say this, hearing it, you're audacious enough to hear it, that's very audacious to hear this, to listen to it, to hear it. To listen to it, and then to feel it, and to be shocked, and the wow, and full, that's very audacious. Very much so. That's what works. That's it. And then positive familiarity with it. Hey, yeah, this is great. I want to experience this. I want to get into this. I want more of this. This is great. Then more comes, you see. The willingness is there. Then you'll look. Your mind will look. And you'll see. Mentally, you'll see it and say, hey, what's going on here? Well, this is ridiculous. I don't need a little... I'm trying to have a life. I don't need to try to have a life. That's absolutely nuts. And you'll see it. And you'll say, oh yeah, great. How stupid. Oh yeah, I've been repeating the same stupid mistake every day of my life, which is having a day of my life. Which is having a day in the life. That is the mistake. All right, very great. I'll get this up. I know, hopefully some of you will watch this. I'm putting a lot of hours of video up. At the same hand, this affords you the opportunity, the audacious opportunity, to hear this stuff and get used to it. This is what's required right now. You need to be audacious enough to realize you don't need any. You don't need to have a life. You are life. I am life. Say that. I know I already successfully know that I already successfully am life. Okay, say that. Practice that. Practice. Very great. That's it for this one.